Jesus imply here? One possibility is this. In the whole spectrum, one possibility is this. Did the Lord Jesus imply those who reject the Holy Spirit? Did he imply those outside who reject the Holy Spirit? That is just a possibility. Number two, let's move it to another level. Did he imply the Pharisees? Because remember, he was talking at that time in the presence of the Pharisees and the Sadducees. Because you have to remember very well that the Lord Jesus, being a prophet, he was aware that a prophet cannot be received in his hometown, even by his people. And the Lord Jesus was also very much aware of the bitter exit that he would have to make. The bitter rejection and the bitter exit. How they would mistreat him, reject him, and kill him. Hallelujah. Or was Jesus talking about the Jews? That's the broad community, the broad class. Because the Pharisees and the Sadducees were just a section of the Jewish community, the Hebrew people. Was the Lord implying the Hebrew people, the Jewish people? Because you can see very clearly that at that time, the Hebrew people, the Jewish people, they did not recognize him as the Messiah. Which essentially means that they did not recognize the new covenant of the grace which he brought. And remember, the difference between the five foolish virgins and the five wise virgins is the jar of oil. And yet we know that the jar of oil essentially stands for the consecrated olive oil, the consecrated anointing oil, stands for the Holy Spirit. Hallelujah. And there is no way the Jewish people, the Jews, and the Pharisees, and the Sadducees would have had to receive the Holy Spirit if they did not embrace the new covenant of the grace of our Lord Jesus. Because the Holy Spirit only came through the new covenant of the grace. Hallelujah. So did Jesus imply the Pharisees, the Sadducees, and the Jewish people? Hallelujah. Let me bring it to another level. Who were these foolish virgins? Because the secret will depend on your ability to receive revelation as to be able to identify whom these foolish virgins were who missed the kingdom of God, that you may avoid being them so you may enter. Hallelujah. And again, I've made it very clear here that it will not depend on your ability to try to define the five wise virgins. Now, let me bring it to another level. Did the Lord Jesus imply by the foolish virgins, did he imply the church that would reject him? Hallelujah. There are several scenarios here you have to understand. Remember that everything that was spoken about Israel, hallelujah, even the rejection that Israel gave unto the Lord Jesus, who is the cornerstone of Israel, by the way, which rejection led to the closure of the eastern gate of Jerusalem, and yet inside that gate was the temple of the Lord, and the eastern gate is closed facing the Mount of Olives where the rapture takes place, and from where the new visitation of the second coming will take place. We know that there is nothing the Lord God spoke to his wife, the wife of Jehovah Israel, that was not a prophecy he was speaking to the bride of Christ, the church. So by the foolish virgins, did the Lord imply the church that would fail to recognize him, reject him, or reject the Holy Spirit, essentially? Hallelujah. Who were these people the Lord referred to? Let me bring it to another level. Did the Lord Jesus imply that church, those of you that received the anointing of the Holy Spirit and then lose it? Because we've seen such cases too. We've seen King Saul in the Bible, anointed of the Lord, And then because he falls out of the obedience of the Lord, the will of the Holy Spirit, he is caused to lose the anointing of the Holy Spirit. We've seen the temple of the Lord in Jerusalem during the time of Ezekiel. The glory of the Lord is in the temple. But because of the fallout, the glory of the Lord leaves the temple of the Lord. That's the anointing of the Holy Spirit. Is somebody following me here? Hallelujah. We also see David, the precious servant of the Lord. The man that the Lord Jehovah himself said, that is a man after my own heart. Remember, David was very special unto the Lord. No wonder the Lord Jesus is said to come back and sit. He's coming back to sit on the throne of his father David. David had the anointing as a prophet of God. The Lord spoke with him at that time by voice and visions and dreams as he speaks to his prophets. David was also raised as a shepherd, a pastor of the Lord's people, Israel. David was anointed in several capacities as a king. Many, many anointings. He had multiple anointings. God loved him. But we see that when David falls to sexual sin, he loses the anointing of the Holy Spirit. Is this the group of people Jesus was implying when he spoke about the five foolish virgins who did not carry the oil? We also see very clearly here several cases in the Bible. Even Eli was a priest ordained by the Lord, favored by the Lord, anointed of the Lord, so he operated under the influence of the Holy Spirit. When he offered the blood, the glory came and sat on the mercy seat of the Ark of the Covenant. That means the Holy Spirit was with him. But when Eli is not able to rebuke sin, even the sexual sin that his sons were involved in, what do you see? We see very clearly that he loses the anointing of the Holy Spirit, and the Ark of the Covenant is taken away into Ashdod by the Philistines. He loses the anointing of the Lord. Are these the people the Lord implied to? Is this the group that Jesus was talking about, symbolizing them, even with the five foolish virgins, who even up to the point of being able to hear the voice of the archangel, still did not enter into the rapture of the church? Who are these people, somebody? There are several cases of servants of God losing the anointing of the Holy Spirit. Hallelujah. Who are these people that fail to enter even after they have heard the voice of the archangel? Because it will strictly depend on the ability of the church to use the wisdom, the anointing of the Holy Spirit, the revelation of the Holy Spirit in defining this category. That is what will allow the church entry into the rapture. There are many cases in the Bible of servants of God, even the men of God from Judah, 1 Kings chapter 13. The men that the Lord sent to speak to the altar when Jeroboam was the king, 1 Kings 13. And you see, the Lord sent him and said, when you go and encounter the altar, and I'm sure he saw it in a dream, I can tell you very clearly, I see every day, I see things, I see people, even before I meet them, I see every event of the day. And this man of God must have also seen this event. That when he went, he would meet Jeroboam at the altar, preparing to offer the defiling, the filthy sacrifice they were offering unto the altar in those high places, and to speak to the altar, to speak to that altar. And you see that when Jeroboam, the king, when the king said, apprehend him, get a hold of him, then the hand of the king remained dry. Hallelujah. There was so much power of the Holy Spirit with the man of God from Judah in 1 Kings 13. But look at this, somebody. After all that, accomplishing the mission, the Lord had initially spoken with him and told him, on your way back, don't use the same route you have used. And don't eat any bread or drink any water. That was the instruction, the command of the Lord. But what do you see here? He uses a different route. And then an old prophet sends his servant, who lies to this young prophet, the man of God from Judah. And the young prophet, the man of God from Judah, goes and eats bread with the old prophet. And in the process, when he goes back, the lion is able to devour him and kill him. And so you see the picture, very, very tough picture, of the donkey standing here on one side of the road. The dead body of the man of God from Judah is here on the road, and the lion is standing on this side. The lion is not able to attack the donkey, and the dead body is lying there. In fact, to bring it to another level, the old prophet comes, the lion is still standing here, the donkey is here, and he pulls away the young prophet who has been killed, the man of God from Judah. And the lion cannot even attack, does not attack the old prophet who lied to the man of God from Judah. We know that the anointing of the Holy Spirit is the favor of the Lord. That is what empowers the church, empowers the Christian, empowers the servants, even protects the servants of God as they are sent by the Lord. So you can see very clearly that the anointing of the Holy Spirit had left this man of God from Judah because of disobedience. Hallelujah. So who were these people that the Lord Jesus is talking about? You see that there is a real possibility here that he could have been talking about the anointed who lose the anointing. And it seems to me that this loss of the anointing of the Holy Spirit only takes place at the midnight hour, at the peak season, when now the bridegroom is coming. Hallelujah. I'm bringing you to the next level. Hallelujah. Because we have seen that the remnant that enters into the rapture of the church is absolutely the remnant of the Lord. Even the word remnant is defined by the Lord himself. This is what we're beginning to see even as this teaching is advancing and progressing. And again, I've spoken very clearly that it will depend on the ability of the church to be able to discern and without a doubt identify the five foolish virgins that did not enter into the kingdom of God, and that out of there is the big gateway for the church to enter into the rapture, because then she can avoid that which the foolish virgins had, so she can see the kingdom of God. I want to move to the next level, even as we look at this mighty, mighty conversation the Lord is having with the church regarding his perfect bride. Now, one of the main things that stands out is the fact that out of the church, those who receive revelation at that point in time that the wedding of the Lamb of God is near, that minority symbolized by the 10 virgins, not 5, 10 virgins, who pick up their lamps and step out into the darkness, we've seen that that is the minority that steps out, the remnant that steps out to go to wait on the bridegroom. But one of the key things that we see clearly, which I want to address right now and in much greater depth, is the fact that they step out into the darkness. What is the Lord speaking on that? What is the message to the church? Even as we elucidate, we open up, unveil this mighty, mighty conversation that marks the finality of the process of preparations for the wedding of the Lamb of God. Now, very clearly, I want to look at the darkness into which the virgins stepped out. Now, the fact that there was darkness out definitely brought a necessity into the virgins taking lamps to go out. Again, I rephrase it. The virgins needed the lamps burning before they could step out and go wait for the chief bridegroom, who is the perfect Lamb of God, who is Christ Jesus, the Messiah. They needed lamps which were lit in order to go out, like the Bible says, so they could wait on the coming of the Lamb of God. What is this darkness that was out there? And we see that when the Lord comes in the midnight hour, hallelujah, in the heart of the darkness of the night, in the midnight hour, he comes in the darkness. So what is this darkness? Let us look at the darkness vis-a-vis the Lord and the virgins. What is the Lord speaking to you as a church today when he says they stepped out in the darkness. Remember very well our Lord Jesus said, I am the light of the world. So this darkness essentially speaks about the world. It speaks about the sinful world. And that essentially also allows us to redefine, re-explain the process of the virgins taking their lamps and stepping out, and even the purpose for which they stepped out with the lamps. Hallelujah. We have seen several cases which we're going to handle, like in the book of Daniel, chapter 12, verses 2 to 3, when the Lord was speaking about the rapture and the rapture saints. And he said, and for those who are wise, they will shine like the brightness of the heavens. And for those who lead many into righteousness, hallelujah, like the stars forever and ever. And you see very clearly that there is a command there. When it comes to the rapture, the Lord was speaking of a commissioning statement, a commissioning of the church. That's why you see that the 10 virgins, having received revelation that the end time has come and the wedding is going to happen very soon, that the bridegroom is going to appear very soon, they stepped out of the church, out. They went out into the darkness, into the world. And so you begin to understand that they took the commissioning statement, they embodied it into their beings, which means they wore it, they carried it, which tells you that they went out to evangelize the dark world. Hallelujah. Again, you see very clearly here that in the book of Daniel, he says, if you bring more, you evangelize more in these last days, you shine like the stars forever and ever. Hallelujah. And those who are wise, I don't want to go into that now. Wisdom. What is wisdom to the Lord? And later I'll explain the true identity of the wise virgins to you. And you see why Daniel said, those who are wise will shine like the brightness of heaven. The Bible in the book of Proverbs, chapter 1, verse 7 says, the fear of the Lord is the beginning of all wisdom. So you see the context under which the Lord used the word wise. And those who are wise will shine like the brightness of the heavens. But let's move step by step into this. The world that we live in is a dark world. That is how the Lord characterizes the world. There is a lot of darkness in the world. And there are several scriptures here that define the church vis-a-vis the world, whereby the world is in darkness and the church has the light. And again, like I said, our Lord Jesus said, I am the light of the world. Let's look very clearly here at the book of Micah, right from the Old Testament. Micah chapter 7, verses 8 to 9. What does the Lord say about this darkness and the light that he brought us? And he says that this is the prophecy that was spoken about the darkness that the Lord speaks about. He says, do not gloat over me, my enemy. Though I have fallen, I will rise. Though I sit in darkness, the Lord will be my light. Again, verse 8, I repeat, do not gloat over me, my enemy. Though I have fallen, I will rise. Though I sit in darkness, the Lord will be my light. So that explains to you very clearly what the Lord meant when he said, I am the light of the world. You see very clearly that that is the light from which his people would tap from. So they too can be the light of the world. Hallelujah. And he still talks about the darkness the people of the Lord sit in. Verse 9 he says, because I have sinned against him, I will bear the Lord's wrath until he pleads my case. And he continues to say, and establishes my right. He will bring me out into the light, and I will see his righteousness. Isn't that amazing? You begin to understand that when the Lord said he is the light of the world, essentially, he implied that there is a darkness out there in the world, and that darkness carries wickedness and evil. And so, he was urging us, as his people, to make sure we seek the light so we can be able to see the righteousness of the Lord. Hallelujah. So in other words, when the five wise virgins and the five foolish virgins received revelation of the coming of the Lord, that the Lord will come very soon in the rapture into the wedding of the Lamb of God, and they lit up their lamps, took the light, hallelujah, and they went out into the darkness, they essentially were emulating, taking up the command, so they too may bring forth the light of the Lord that they have found unto the dark world. So that speaks about the righteousness that they were supposed to reflect, hallelujah, and that also brings into definition, into this picture, he that gave them the light. Who lit their lamps? So they would be able to bring into the dark world the light that only comes from the Lord. Because only the Lord is the light of the world. Let us advance this very slowly. In the book of Ezekiel chapter 1, again we are still talking about our Lord Jesus being the light of the world. Ezekiel chapter 1, verse 27. This is what he says here, precious people. Ezekiel was describing the throne around the Lord when the Lord, he opened the eyes of Ezekiel, the prophet of God, and Ezekiel was able to look and see the throne of God. This is what he saw. Just one verse, verse 27. Ezekiel 1:27. This is what he says. He says, I saw that from what appeared to be his waist up, he looked like glowing metal, as if full of fire, and that from there down he looked like fire, and brilliant light surrounded him. So you begin to understand why the Lord said, I am the light of the world. Because around the throne of God, there is the brilliant light of the Lord. And we are seeing very clearly here that that light is what allows his people, hallelujah, to see the righteousness of the Lord. And we know that the righteousness of the Lord is an absolute requirement for the five wise virgins even to enter into the kingdom of God. Hallelujah. You see how I'm pulling this, I'm beginning to derive this for you, so you may understand exactly why the virgins carried the lamps they carried. They did not carry ornamental lamps. I know in many homes, you get some lamps which are very ornamental, decorative purpose. This is not for decorative purpose. They carried lamps, so the lamps would help them in the darkness of the world where they were heading to, so they can be the light of that world, reflecting the light of the world that is our Lord Jesus. Hallelujah. In other words, becoming the bearers of the light of the Lord in the dark world. Is somebody following me here? And we're going to get very deep here. This is an absolute mighty revelation to the church. So they may be able to be the bearers of the mighty light of the Lord, who is the light of the world. So they too may be the light of the world in the darkness of the world. But the light that they carried, hallelujah, even by the lamps they carried, was not just for purposes of the dark world to see the light that was Christ in them, hallelujah, but was also for purposes of enabling them to walk right within the darkness of the world. Personal now, that they too may walk right. And I'm going to walk you into every scripture that talks about every single element I've mentioned here. Which means there was going to be a process once they reach out in that darkness, in the process of waiting for the Lord, in the process of being on the watch out, and this is the minority that steps out to go watch out, wait on the Lord, there would be a process, and as they go through that process, they don't want to stumble and fall. They want to see the rocks as they put their feet right. Your lamp is a light unto my feet. Hallelujah. But let me walk you very slowly, step by step, so we may understand even how that light becomes a key feature in the process of waiting on the chief bridegroom that is coming in the rapture of the church. In fact, that is the most important feature that will eventually distinguish the five foolish virgins from the wise virgins, and vice versa. Now, the book of John chapter 1, verses 1 to 5, still talking about Christ, the light of the world. And once we understand the light that he brought, then we'll understand the quality of light that he was talking about, which the five wise virgins were able to maintain, so they could be, first of all, distinguished from the light that the five foolish virgins were giving. Hallelujah. Number two, that you may understand the quality of life that the five wise virgins were carrying, that was able to bring quality into their waiting process. Hallelujah. So they may be able to enter the kingdom of God. Hallelujah. Again, understanding the nature of the Lord as the light of the world will enable us also to understand the quality of life, the distinction between the quality of life that the wise virgins had compared to the quality of life that the foolish virgins had. Hallelujah. Which quality of light enabled the wise virgins to be able to perform even in the last moment, the peak hour, when everything's setting, the anxiety, the fear that you see in very soon, when finally the announcement has been made, and all the other lamps are going low, they're dying, they're extinguishing, they're going dim, yet the quality of light that the five wise virgins had, in fact, went up and up from one level of glory to the next, thereby enabling them to perform at peak time the last days, hallelujah, and to enter into the wedding banquet of the Lamb of God. Now we are working on the mechanics of the process that allows the remnant church to enter into the wedding of the Lamb of God. And that's why I said, I'm going to dissect it for you such that no stone will be left unturned, and such that at the end of this session, it will be clear without a speck of a doubt what you ought to do so you can enter into the kingdom of God. And I'm bringing this to you very much aware of the fact that every letter of every word written in this book, the Bible, will be fulfilled on that day. So it's absolutely important that we understand that the King of Wisdom, our Lord, when he spoke these are things that have a lot of revelation embedded underneath, thereby requiring the wisdom of the Holy Spirit, so we may be able to understand for purposes of entering into the kingdom of God. But again, we see very clearly here that therefore the lamp was necessary because there was darkness out. And the lamp was necessary because it's a commissioning statement that was spoken to the remnant that now steps out to wait on the bridegroom. That for those who will lead many into the righteousness of the Lord, they will shine like the stars forever and ever on the day of the rapture. At the same time, we see that the light that the 10 virgins carried had to have a certain quality, so they too may not stumble and fall, which light, whose quality would allow them to see the rocks and the little stones even as they are walking along this path in the darkness of the world and are waiting for the coming of the bridegroom, so they may enter having not fallen. Hallelujah. Which quality of light, I repeat, would be able to withstand the heavy storms of the midnight hour, the heavy winds that were going to come at the midnight hour, when all the other lamps would be extinguished and dying and dimming out, so they would still be able to perform and enter. Hallelujah.
¿Qué sería de mí si no me hubieras alcanzado? ¿Dónde estaría hoy si no me hubieras perdonado. Tendría un vacío en mi corazón, vagaría sin rumbo, sin dirección. Si no fuera por tu gracia y por tu amor, si no fuera por tu gracia y por tu amor.